the next room of this very one, the man with the golden gun. Love is required whenever he's hired, comes just before.
Although Roger Moore made a respectable debut as the new 007 in Live and Let Die, his second outing, The Man with the Golden Gun, proved to be far less successful. But before I get to that, let me tell you a bit about the film. The Man with the Golden Gun is extremely loosely based on the 12th novel, which was also the last one that Ian Fleming wrote before his death. As a matter of fact, due to the fact that it was published after his death and is considered to be less detailed than previous works, many people believe that Fleming never actually finished the book, and that he certainly didn't edit it, and that someone else finished the book. Having said this, it's also worth noting that the producers originally planned to make The Man with the Golden Gun after Live and Let Die, and may have even offered the role of Bond to Roger Moore at the time. As the novel was a direct sequel to Live and Let Die, this would have made sense, although there usually isn't much continuity between the films, and they wound up deciding not to do that anyway. The film disregards parts of the novel dealing with Bond having amnesia and being brainwashed by the Soviet Union, and instead focuses solely on the conflict between Bond and Scaramanga, who is the titular man with the golden gun. Scaramanga is played by Christopher Lee, who was actually Ian Fleming's cousin, and he was once considered to play Dr. No, and some say he was even considered to play Bond himself. The film also features a prominent character from the novels, Mary Goodnight, played by Britt Ekland, who, despite being one of the more attractive Bond girls, plays the character as hopeless and helpless ditz. Also of note is Scaramanga's concubine, Andrea Anders, played by Maud Adams, who would appear twice more in the series playing other characters, and his henchman Nick Knack, played by Herve Villechaize. The film starts with a nameless character who might possibly have been one of the gangsters from Diamonds Are Forever, the actor plays a similar role in that film, seemingly paying his way into a duel with Scaramanga, who lures him into a bizarre funhouse and shoots him to death in the Hall of Mirrors. He also shoots the fingers off of a wax statue of Bond he has. Flash forward to London, where M has received a not-so-cryptic message, a golden bullet, the kind known to be used by Scaramanga, engraved with the number 007, a clear message that the man with the golden gun is gunning for Bond. M takes Bond off active duty, as he fears that he may not be a match for Scaramanga, but Bond goes after him anyway. There really isn't much more to the plot, other than Bond trying to kill Scaramanga before he gets killed by him. Though there is a subplot involving a device that harnesses the power of the sun and can be used as a weapon, something that would be seen again as a concept in Die Another Day, and Bond having to retrieve the device. Well, the problem with the film is that it's not very compelling. At no point is the plot interesting, and at no point is it executed well. The entire thing comes off as dull and uninspired, a far cry from the excitement of movies like Goldfinger and On Her Majesty's Secret Service. The main Bond girl in the film comes off as a complete idiot. The scene with Bond learning karate and then getting defended by two little girls is really nothing more than laughable, and there's just way too many cheap laughs thrown in, like the naked Japanese girl named Chu Mi, or the fascination with Scaramanga's superfluous third nipple. Even the action scenes are stunted as the ridiculous Sheriff Pepper character pops up again, and though at first you may think, oh, he's just there for a cameo, the character latches onto Bond and there's yet another huge extended chase scene. Thankfully, the character never appeared again in the series. Roger Moore himself seems bored with the movie, Christopher Lee comes off like a little kid play-acting cops and robbers, and, well, the less said about Nick Knack, the better. Perhaps worst of all, the film features one of the coolest car stunts ever put on film, a giant corkscrew leap that the producers had actually patented years before so they could use it in a Bond film, and the effect is completely ruined by a ridiculous slide whistle sound effect. The movie is so lifeless and dull, I can't even enjoy it on an ironic level. Well, to say The Man with the Golden Gun is the worst Bond film is no understatement. I give the film a 2 out of a possible 10.